Welcome to session 3 of the Practical Leadership Training. I hope you've been following along and you've been able to put in the effort and to do the pre-work. In this session, we're going to talk about the third element of the course, which is about resource allocation and building teams. This is so important. Have you ever been to a situation where you are in a church and you don't feel like the team is together or united working in the same direction? So it is an important topic. People is the most important asset of the church. So how do we build teams? How did Nehemiah do it? We're going to study Nehemiah chapter 3. Now, when we do this course, I'm always mindful of this quotation from Ellen White in Testimony Volume 9, page 117. She says, "We're standing on the very borders of the eternal world. We have no time to lose. There should be well-organized plans. Those who labor visiting the churches should give the brethren and sisters instructions in practical methods of doing missionary work." And I hope that the training that we're doing together is practical. The first practical thing that we learned was the five-year plan, the importance of doing it. And last week, you learned about ICM, Influence Communication Map. We're going to learn something practical again today and how to build upon that and work upon that. Nehemiah chapter 3 is about building effective teams. I hope that you've been reading the book of Nehemiah, especially in chapter 3. Now, I hope you have downloaded the lesson. It is very, very important to download the lesson and to write over it, scribble over it as you follow along. And the other thing about this lesson, Nehemiah chapter 3, is an incredible chapter because there's a lot of Hebrew names in it. You know, it's not one of those chapters you want to stand out loud and read all these Hebrew names and pronounce them rightly or wrongly or accurately. So the way to study Nehemiah 3, because it's almost like a genealogy with all the names, it is important to print it out. So I've actually printed out Nehemiah chapter 3, and I've given you on the website the folder to download and print a copy so that you can circle over it. You're going to have to write over it because it's one of those texts in scripture that you have to look for patterns, look for things that are consistently repeated in here. So if you have not done any of those two, I ask you to pause the video now and go and do that. Today, we're going to continue our study in Nehemiah chapter 3. Some people define a team as together, everyone achieves more. Let's learn what the Bible says. What is the definition of teams and how do we build effective team so that God's work can be progressed and work in an organized plan? Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, as we study your word together now, we ask that your Spirit will guide us and you will lead us. You will show us about our own strength, our own gifts and our talents, and also of our team, whether it be elders team, whether it be church board, whether it be care group teams, whether church plant teams. Lord, we need to know how to work with teams effectively in your church. Lord, you're the head of the church. Show us how to be your servant leader in this regard. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Together, everyone achieves more. Is that the definition of team in scripture? Well, I think there is a better definition of teams. I want you to read this quotation in Testimony Volume 9, page 221. It says something like that. If Christians were to act in concert, moving forward as one, under the direction of one power, for the accomplishment of one purpose, they would move the world. See, the definition team is moving forward as one. That is the good definition of team. You know, I remember a story about the USA Dream Team in 2004. The United States team has not lost an Olympic game for 24 consecutive games. They were, when the professional NBA teams were allowed to participate in the Olympics, they always had dream team after dream team after dream team. But came 2004, it was different. They had well-known names, James LeBron, and they had top champion players. They were brought in by Larry Brown, the head coach. But unfortunately, America did not defend their gold medal. They end up coming in as third place with the bronze medal. What happened here? It was almost a big disaster in the country. How could this sport, basketball, which is, they believe, invented in America, could be lost to all other nations? Well, because there's a difference between a team of champions or a champion team. There's a difference between a team with many individual champions as opposed to a one purpose, one direction, one accord champion team. I think that's where we want to go. We want to create a team, not just individuals of or champions in the church, but working together. The Bible says it's in Philippians chapter 2, verse 2 and 3. Fulfill ye my joy for being or having the same love, being in one accord of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Philippians chapter 2, verse 2 to 3. Did you see that? Being in one accord, having one mind, which is the mind of Christ. Because verse 5 says, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. Nehemiah brought 9 powerful principles of team building. How many did I say? 9 powerful principles. It's amazing, isn't it? This book will provide such a kind of instruction for us today. You know, sometimes you go to a church, you inherit a team. Maybe you are a pastor, move in, you inherit a team of elders that are already there for many, many years. And how do you make a change? Maybe the team doesn't want to change. Maybe they're quite set in their ways. Maybe you have a team, but it's very functional, very functional. They value, maybe it's your worship team. They just value worship. And so all they're thinking about is week to week to week, but there's no vision moving forward. There's no vision moving forward. And there's no change that is, they're just tinkering and fine-tuning rather than having a dramatic improvement to worship. There is a difference between a functional team and a team driven by vision. Nehemiah had a team driven by vision. You know the story in chapter 2, he walked around the walls. Then he began to start the rebuilding project. He said, come, let us rise together. And he pulled them in one accord of one mind. He pulled the people together with incredible change management strategies. And here in the picture of the walls of Jerusalem, he worked in chapter 3, you can see verse 1 starts with the sheep gate. And he goes around counterclockwise and he placed resources accordingly to the work that is required. 9 key principles that we're going to deal with in building a champion team. How do you make that team? How do you build a team? Perhaps some of you are coming to an end of the nomination committee and you're the leader appointed for that Sabbath school or for that worship or for that care group. How can you build your team so that you would implement the vision God has for you? Well, Nehemiah showed us how to do that. 9 points. The first one. Nehemiah chapter 3 is one of those chapters, like I say, with lots of names, lots of names of city, lots of names of people, lots of names of roles, and so on. Here's the point I want to get across. Because they had the same purpose and same vision, let us build together, arise and build. The leader here is a person that can handle the plan, the details of the plan. You see, to build a team, you need to roll up your sleeve. You need to roll up your sleeve, you need to get your hands dirty, you need to be involved, you got to be in the front line. There's no point being aloof. There's no point standing in the distance and try to direct the work in their team. You see, Nehemiah is different. You see the way he's able to handle details. With the amount of details that's captured in chapter 3, you can see he's a man that doesn't just stay in a high level and just say, oh, give me a summary report and I'll tell you what to do. Call me when you need me. That kind of leader. He's not that kind of leader. He's a leader that builds team by getting his hands in on the palm and rowing the boat together. That's the kind of leader he is. He could deal with the details. The second thing you notice, and when you're studying Nehemiah chapter 3 and you're using that piece of paper and you're circling all the words, you circle the verbs. Did you notice that the primary verbs that exist is the word repair? The word repair occurred many times throughout this chapter. And there's a different kind of role when you try to repair something. Repair is trying to fix something that's broken, right? Maybe it's you're repairing a tap, you're repairing a part of the wall, repairing the gate, repairing the fence. So it's part of fixing something that's already there. Now the second row you find is built, all right? You see the word built often mentioned. Built has to do with starting from nothing, building from scratch. You know, maybe there's a time you need to do that in a church. You need to build up a new team because now with COVID-19, media evangelism is more important. You need to build a new media team. You know, repair is just fixing something that's there. Maybe you need to fine-tune and improve the music in worship. and just repairing that. Maybe the roster is not working so well. You need to kind of work on that roster. Now, the third one, you notice is the word fortify. That's not mentioned too often, but that word is in there. Fortify means to make it stronger, to make it more robust, make it more solid. And there are times we need to do that. We need to strengthen people. We need to strengthen the troops. We need to build up their biblical knowledge. We have to fortify. We have to strengthen the church. And this is a place for all these three. You cannot just be a church that is just purely constantly just repairing. Repairing alone will not get the job done. We need to build. We also have to build. So building is important, and fortifying is also equally important. Three roles. So as a leader, we need to know what are the roles for that team. I remember when we started the church plant. When we started the church plant, one of the things we need to clarify is who does what. And you know, you can read church manual, but it's very wordy. There's a lot of roles described there. But what I did was that I took a one-pager and I put them in columns, and I laid out the roles of the different key people and key roles in the church, all in one page. Because it's a church plant, we have about 20, 30 people when we started off. All we need to do is define the key roles. And in dot point, I describe their responsibility. By having a one pager on an A4, we got to see who does what. Too often when we don't define the role, the team goes into conflict or they overlap, they trip over each other. So defining roles is a very important work in leadership. And that's how you build a good team. The third one is, you notice this. Leaders know his resources have different gifts and talents. We know how to watch for the good resources and different talents, different spiritual gifts that they have. You know, there were 42 separate groups of people in Nehemiah chapter 3. 42. You just notice that you scan this. You notice in verse 1, it talks about the priests. You come down to verse 17. It talks about the Levites. And then verse 31, 32. It talks about the goldsmith and so on. So different roles came in. Some were city dwellers. Some were community from outside the city that came in. They had leaders that of districts, of half a district. They can mobilize the work. So they know family groups who live in which house and next house. So a lot of detail goes into understanding the resource. One of the challenges in building team in a local church is that we don't have a skills inventory. If you're new, you're a pastor or new to the church, you don't know who's who in the zoo. We don't have a way to know. It takes a year or two to figure out who does what and what gifts, what talents God has given us. And too often we just lead blindly, and this is not healthy. Nehemiah was good in watching for the resource and the talents that are there. This is an important element for us to know what are the gifts of our people. The fourth one is this. Notice in chapter 3, in verse 1, then Eliashib the high priest rose up with his brethren and the priests and built the ship gate, and they consecrated and hung it the doors. They built it as far as the Tower of the Hundreds and consecrated then as far as the Tower of Hananel. Notice that? Chapter 3, verse 1. The first group that went out to, that is mentioned, are the spiritual leaders, the priests. You see, Eliashib actually really means God restores. God restores. What a good name, isn't it? God restores. It very correspond well with the story that we are talking about here. So we need to lead by example. Spiritual leader needs to lead by example. Now, I remember talking to some young leaders, especially like a young intern pastor. I remember talking to them and I said, look, you know, it's not what you preach on it. And you like to preach. I understand it. And we have many young preachers that love to preach. But I said, it's not just the preaching. It's your example that you set. I mean, if we set up church in the morning and we need to set up the welcome table, bring the Bibles and sort out the bulletin and all that, I say, you come early. You come early and work with the ushering team. You work with them, you mingle with the people, you welcome the people. Don't just roll in here 5 minutes before Sabbath school start. Come here half an hour before Sabbath school start. Set up the church, get it ready. When the deacons set up the church, you work with them. Be the last to leave the church. You see, we've got to lead by example. Too often as leaders, we just want to preach, we want to teach, we want to sit in committees, we want to chair committees, but that's not what team building is all about. Team building is about getting there in the work that's important. Starting the ship gate, because the ship gate has a lot to do with the spiritual side of the church. So they started with the spiritual change that is necessary. The spiritual change is really important. The fifth one is this. Notice with me that some of the names are from people from outside the city. There are in fact 7 other cities mentioned here. Jericho, Tokea, Gibeon, Mizpah, and so on. These are many names of other cities in Judah. And they were not the cities of Jerusalem, but people came from these other cities to help the rebuilding work in Jerusalem. Here's the thing. The key point is this. God may send you people because people resonate with your vision, resonate with the direction you want to go. But the question is this, would you integrate them? Would you get them involved? You know, I remember going to a group that exists. I was going there to coach this work, but the team has already established, and a few of us came to help this work. The core team was a little bit reticent to allow new people to come and be involved in the team, because sometimes they're doubtful. Oh, are they going to stay long? They're doubtful. Do they have the same values as we have? Or do they have the same DNA? Would they impact our dynamics as a group? Sometimes we're so protective. When God sends us resources, our eyes are not open to see it. We think that they're going to be more trouble than it's worth. But actually, if we learn to integrate them, we learn to know their gifts and their talents, they actually complement our work really well. So don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to integrate one that God has sent to you. Too often we try our best to use just only our internal resource, but actually God has more resource for our work. We need to open our eyes to that. Some people say, oh, but they don't know our rules and don't know our standard and all that. Well, then educate them. Take time. Because, you know, when you bring in those resources that are enthusiastic and see your passion and see your vision for the work, they can add value and the work will multiply more. So there may be a slight delay for you to train and equip them and help them to be integrated part of the group, but it's well worth the while. Okay, that's the fifth point, in external resource. In chapter 3, you notice that there's a high level of coordination. You see phrases like, next to them, come with me in verse 4, and next to them, you notice that phrase, and then end of verse 4, next to them, Zodak, and then verse 5, next to them, the Tokias, right? Next to them. This word next to them, after him. There's a lot of coordination that is happening going on here. Nehemiah didn't miss a beat. He wanted to make sure that the people working next to each other can work well with each other. And too often we don't take care of that. We don't look at the overall group dynamics. I think this is very important. Nehemiah was the kind of leader that he planned it all out to try to put the resource in the right place. Not individual silos doing their own thing, but actually a team of champion team working together. You know, it's like a care group. If you're in a care group leader, you know that if you're naturally friends, and you put people who are naturally friends into the same care group, the warmth, the friendship, the laughter, the joy of being together makes a big impact rather than 3 or 4 or 5 acquaintances getting together, but they're just serving together. It's almost like they're co-workers in a church rather than friends in a care group. It's nice to be friends in a care group rather than co-worker in a care group. So next to them is an important concept about coordination. And God wants us to learn to coordinate as we build team. Number 7, build commitment by the leaders. The leaders are very good at building ownership. Nehemiah was excellent in doing this. Notice with me how he was putting them near their homes. Verse 21, from the door of house of Eliashib to the end of his house. Notice that. And then notice that it goes on to say, opposite their house, verse 23, made repairs opposite their house, made repairs or by his house, opposite their house, by his house. Notice they were doing their work near their homes. Now, why is that important? You see, because if the work is close to your home, you will pay attention to it because you're going to face this work, these walls on a regular basis. You want the walls to be secure for your family living in your home. You see, Nehemiah is very clever. He assigned people to work close to the home. It's very efficient. So you don't have to travel across town to the other side of the wall. You actually work on the walls near your home. He created ownership. He created buy-in. He created efficiency. And assigned people where they have the greatest burden. If you want a team to work well, listen well to your team members. Listen to their burden. Listen to their passion of their heart. Listen to the people group that they have a burden for, and put them in that area where they are closest to their passion, closest to their burden. That will create ownership. That will build it up. You know why a church or a group doesn't head well in the same direction? It's because there's little ownership. There's little ownership. If there is no vision and it's just maintenance, that ownership will wear out and people will kind of burn out or rust out. But if there is a vision and there is ownership of the work will excel and progress. And so that's why it's important that we as leaders know how to build this kind of ownership into the team. I remember working with one team, and I realized that they were pretty much co-workers in the team. They were not really friends, and that didn't help too much. It's so important that we started making some remixing of our care group so that there is greater ownership. There was a group of people that had greater burden for young professionals, and it's greater ownership when they get together and with passion, they work together reaching out to young professionals. They were kind of like mixed within the campus care group, and they had little ownership of the campus work because they kind of feel like it's past their time. They're not really that interested in that group. Not because they're not interested in soul winning. It's just that it was a time that they have a burden for another demographics. Likewise, we had families that were supporting campus ministry, and that's good for a time, but then slowly the ownership wanes away. It is important to put people where they have a burden and ownership to work for a people group, and they have a vision for their work, and they can team together, and when they are together, they will excel and do much better because the Spirit of God can work in their hearts. Now, the eighth point, this is very important. Know that there are laggards in the work. Laggards are those who will not put their hand to the palm. Sadly, in the church, you won't get 100% of people that are willing to work. You won't get 100% of the people that are willing to work, sadly. You notice here in verse 5 and 6, that next to them the Tekoites made repair, but their nobles did not put their shoulder to the work of the Lord. The nobles did not put their shoulder to the work. There are people like that. They're just whinging and complaining. They talk about the problem. They make it sound like they want to do something, but they don't do nothing. They're just good in talking. They refuse to do the work. They're almost like bystander critic. They're a spectator critic. You know, sadly, there are people like that, and this has happened. The nobles that refuse to put their shoulder to the work. In fact, because they refuse to do the work, others had to do extra work. Notice verse 27. And you notice that it says here, after them, the Tekoites repair another section, additional work, next to the great projecting tower. So sometimes it's not very equitable. It's not very equitable. But you know, that's the reality. That's the reality even in God's work. When you're doing God's work, don't be afraid. I know at best we want everybody to be sharing the equal load. I know at best that's what we want to achieve. But that's not going to be 100% all the time. There will be times when not everybody is ready to go forward. But if the most of them want to go forward, and the Spirit of God, you've been praying, and the Spirit of God is leading, and there's no red flags, there's no blockage, that the Lord has opened a door, we need to press forward. Even though the laggards don't want to put the shoulder to the work. Yes, others may have to pick up the slack. Others may have to do more than is required. But it is necessary to press forward. You know, people who pick up the slack, I know there are many of you that do that. You know, people, you're supposed to be part of a worship team. People calling sick. People calling last minute, I can't lead the song service. Or last minute, I can't teach the Sabbath class. I know as leaders, you find that very frustrating and very, very challenging. And I tell you why. It's challenging because you know you give them that role, you want it to be the best for them. You want them to learn from being a teacher, you want to learn from the joy of serving in music. You want the best for them. But at times, people will not put their shoulder to the work. If that's the case, there are others that will pick it up. Why? If we keep complaining and whinging between the two groups and we compare people in church, I tell you, as a leader, you'll be worn out. If we cast our eyes to the things of this world and see the unfairness and injustice, we'll be discouraged. You know, when things like this happen, look up. Look up. Because the head of the group is Jesus, not you. You're the one feeling discouraged, but actually, God knows better. God knows that others who took up the additional work were blessed. by what they have done. Yes, look up, because God is the one that will lead his work, and he will bring the people to help with his work at the right place at the right time. People who serve wholehearted are named in this book. Wholeheartedly, they are named in this book. And people that are not, actually, were shamed in this book, actually. Their names were written in this book as well. It's very interesting, isn't it? I'm not saying that you go around shaming somebody else. I'm just saying God knows. God knows. It's written in the Bible as a record for us. The whole things of record of good or bad is in God's hands. You just be faithful as a leader. Do what is best. And if you have to do extra, treat it that you are doing for the Lord. Point number 9, leaders give credit to others. Notice the whole chapter, verse 32 verses of Nehemiah chapter 3. There is nothing mentioned about Nehemiah's name. It is so amazing how he actually has so many other names. 75 names were mentioned in this chapter, but not his own name. Nehemiah knew them by name. You know, it reminded me when I was working in the airline industry, I had a general manager, a CEO of the company that actually was very well liked by the employees. He would walk in the aircraft hangar and he knew the engineers by name. He would walk and he would roll up his sleeve. He's a management boy walking around and he knew people by name. He called people on a first name basis. He walked, when I go to meetings and I see him, you know, I've seen him dress down people. If he's very tough, he can be very tough. But yet at the same time, I noticed that he can be very personal, very personable. When I remember going to meetings with him, he would know me by name, he would know and ask about my family and so on. That's a pretty amazing art, to know people's name. Leaders, simple thing. Know your team members' name and their family names and care for their needs first. Don't just use them in your team. If you're just using them in your team, people can see that. People only know that you care if you have cared for them. You see, when you want to work well in a team, the key element is this. We have a clear vision together. Communicate with them the vision, the purpose, the vision. Number 2, show care to them as individuals. They're not your colleagues. They're not your hired servant. They're not paid. They're all volunteers as well. Care for them and their families. Be a friend. When you be a friend, then you serve well together. The third point is to serve well together. Give affirmation is vital. Leaders know how to do that. They know how to affirm people. They give credit. They recognize the work. These 9 elements of building a good team is on the prerequisite that this team have a vision, common vision, and common values. If you don't have common vision and common values, you can have an operational team, a functional team. It can serve for a while, but people will say after 1 year or 2 years, and they tell the nominating committee in the church, that's enough. I don't want to serve as a Sabbath school superintendent anymore. Because to them, it's just a functional duty that I fulfill and serve the church. It's different when you have a common vision and you want to drive a change, you want to see the blessings of a change together. The team will stay together and work towards it together. Implement these 9 steps, 9 principles of team building, and you see a dramatic change in your team, and you will see the result that God wants us to see in His church.